If I said Takara Tommy, how many of you know what I'm talking about? It was a toy manufacturer or designer in Japan who started out with humanoid type figures and later went to robotic figures. And they were figures that would transform themselves into everyday things like vehicles and machines or electronics or weapons or anything like that. That's where it all began in 1984. What we know as the Transformers. And that craze started in 1984 and it hit the world with a bang. Toy companies all over the place picked up on it and made millions and billions of dollars on Transformers. There were movies made as recently as 2012 about Transformers. And the inventor of these things thought he was brilliant. He made a fortune and he thought about Transformers. But really, transformation of things was not a new thing in 1984. It had been around since creation, if you think about it. Because really that's what a butterfly does. It transforms from a caterpillar into a butterfly. So transforming has always been around. 2,000 years ago, give or take, there was something else transformed in this world. The unfortunate part is that millions of people missed it and still miss it. And I don't see very many people getting excited about it. I see some people trying to make money from it, but I don't see a lot of people getting excited about it. Jesus was born of a virgin. It was prophesied that he'd be born of a virgin. It was prophesied that he would be the one that God was sending to be king, to be the Christ, the Messiah, the deliverer. And he came born of a virgin. Somehow they missed it. He did a ministry of miracles. He healed people. He walked on water. He changed water to wine. He stopped the wind. Can you imagine someone saying, "Hold the wind, stop," right there. And it stops. He did that. And they kept saying, "But we want to see a sign." He raised people from the dead. Never happened before. Healed a blind man from birth that never ever has happened before or since. He did all of those things. And those things were a sign that pointed to who he was. But he only did those things because his goal was to call people higher, to call people back to their Creator God. And for that, he got a mock trial. He was despised and rejected, just as it was prophesied he would be. They destroyed a holy and righteous man in the most cruel way you can destroy a life in this world. And people look at that today and they say, "Wow." But I got news for you. That was just the beginning. That was just the beginning. This morning I thought it would be good for us to look back and to see what Jesus transformed in this world for us. It's not a toy. It's not a movie. It's reality. And he did some transformations that no one else could do. You know, the Romans were known for their cruelty. They were known for being people who enjoyed the suffering and the pain and the torture of their enemies. And they knew how to do it better than any other people on earth at that time. They knew how to give someone the most torture and pain without them succumbing to death. And one of those things was the cross. And the Jews knew it too. And they put Jesus on that cross. And that cross in Jesus' day was a symbol of torture. It was a symbol of brutal death. Slow, agonizing death. It was a tool of evil man. It was so evil, it was so wicked, that the Romans said their own citizens couldn't die that way because it was too brutal. Their kingdom citizens were exempt from the cross. That's how bad it was. The suffering, the shame, the humiliation of someone hanging on the cross, that was a torture in and of itself. And they knew that. The disgrace that came with it. But when Jesus came up out of that grave that Satan couldn't hold him in, his resurrection, he transformed that cross. And when I talk about that cross, I'm talking about everything that happened on that cross. Because now we look to that cross and we see something totally different. He transformed it from a cruel tool of death to a sign of forgiveness. It was the cross we look at as a symbol of love, because it was love that put him on that cross. We look at the cross as a symbol of restored life. When Jesus was going to the cross, he didn't say, "God, put me on that cruel cross and let me suffer." He said, "Father, glorify me." He changed the outlook of the cross. It became a symbol of grace, a gift that only God could give. He transformed that cross completely from evil to a good thing. But he didn't stop there. There's a couple other things he transformed with his resurrection. Where is the place that everybody dreads to go? Absolutely everybody dreads to go. It is the grave. We don't look forward to the grave. Have you ever noticed that? No one wants the grave. Because that grave symbolizes an end. A finality. It's all gone. A place of no return. Dark, cold, places of death. It's where the dead go, where no one else wants to go. When we look at the grave, I don't know, I've done a few funerals. I've been around people that have passed away and had to be buried. And I remember one person coming up, and it was their child that they put in the grave. And the mother came to me after the service and after the graveside service. And she said, "It looks so cold." Because that's how we look at it. We look at it that way. And Jesus went to the grave. And he transformed the grave. Think about it. Jesus said, "Oh, they've just fallen asleep. They're just going to a resting place, a temporary resting place. Because in me, if you're in Christ, That grave can't keep you. It can't hold on to you. It couldn't hold on to him. Therefore, it can't hold on to us who are his. It's not going to keep us there. And he talked about it being a resting place, a place where people go to sleep. But he told us there's a future after. And so we don't look at the grave anymore as an ending place. We look at it a place where we change citizenship, where we change our dwelling place, that's all. We're moving on. It's not an end. And so he transformed the grave by his resurrection. He also transformed life. You know, there's a site on the internet you can go on. It's called goodreads.com. Now, I could tell you that it's not all Goodreads, but it's called that. And on that site, you can get 43,474 quotes from different people about life. That's a lot of quotes. I looked through some of them. But it gives you an idea when you read them where people are at or what they're focusing on in life. And what I've found out is people in the world most often focus on physical life. They focus on the 70 to 80 years, if we're blessed, that we live on this earth. They focus on the temporary nature of this earth, of this life, how short it is, and therefore their thinking most times is we got to get all we can get, we got to do everything that we want to do, and they have this big bucket list, and that's what they want to do with this life. Because this life they view as when it hits the grave, it's over. I'm going to read you some quotes about some people, what they wrote. You may be shocked. One fellow said, good friends, good books, get this, and a sleepy conscience, this is the ideal life. Now you all know who that is. His name is Mark Twain. That's what he said. Jimi Hendrix, on the other hand, he said, I'm the one that's got to die when it's time for me to die, and so let me live my life the way I want to live my life. That's how he viewed life. You live it the way you want to, do the best you can, because after 70 years or whatever, you're done. Audrey Hepburn said, the most important thing is to enjoy your life, to be happy. It's all that matters. That is how people view life. And so when you have that view of life, which, by the way, if you don't know God and don't have God, you have no other way to view it. You have no other way to view this life. Then you might as well go after all you can get. Fulfill your lusts. Go after all the power and the prestige and everything you can get. Because in your view, when it's done, it's done. But Jesus shed some light on that. He transformed that way of thinking in this world. When he said, this life is temporary. But life that you need to look at is life that is eternal. And this life only leads to that life. This life doesn't end here, and it isn't about chasing after everything here. Life carries on after here. But it's important how you live this life as to where your life is going to carry on. And so he gave us the option of living a pure life. A life for God, our Creator, who designed us to live life a certain way. And he said, that's what's best for you, and that's also what's going to result in glory for you, because you will then be in glory with me. And so he gave us a whole new view of life. He transformed life. And when he came up out of that grave, his resurrection proved that he had transformed life, that there was life after the grave. And so the last thing that he changed, that he transformed, was death. Now you think about that for a minute. You go on that same site, goodreads.com, you'll find over 15,000 quotes on death. And it's interesting because most people look at death as scary. They don't want to face it alone. Do you know the number one fear of death is that I will die by myself with no one around me? That's what most people fear. They fear that more somehow than if God's with them. If he's the one carrying them over the Jordan. It's strange. But it's that facing the unknown. It's viewed as darkness. It's viewed as loss. And most people, and it's interesting, most people in this generation, in the last century, are terrified of death. Before that, people weren't as terrified of death. They realized it was a part of life. It was part of their talk through life, their death. And they actually looked forward to it, a lot of people. But this last century, people have become terrified of death. And we are known for trying to extend life. Some scientists are trying to make us live eternal in this world. But most people are terrified today of dying. Death is so terribly final, while life is so full of possibilities. George R.R. Martin said that. Will Rogers, who knows Will Rogers here? A couple of us still, it dates us a little bit, but Will Rogers. He said, if there's no dogs in heaven, then when I die, I want to go where they went. Figure that one out. That's his view on death. The meaning of life is that it stops. That's Frank Kafka said that. Rob Sheffield said, when we die, we will all turn into songs and we will hear each other and remember each other. Now, I realize we hear some of that or we read some of that and we go, huh, yeah, really? Because of our view and our understanding and our God, who has by grace saved us from our sin and given us eternal life. So we look at it differently than the world does, but that's where the world's at. And those are some people that are famous or were famous in the world, said those things. Jesus said death isn't scary. He said it's asleep. But he says death can be a victory. A victory because you have overcome here, because he overcame, and you are moving on to be with him eternally. And so death isn't a bad thing. In fact, in death we find reward. Am I saying I want to die tomorrow? I'm not saying that. But if that's what I'm going to do tomorrow, if that's what God's got in store for me tomorrow, it's not a bad thing. I'm moving on to my eternal destination. So Jesus transformed death into something that was ugly to being something that instead of dreading, we can look forward to. And we can look forward to it with confidence. 1 Corinthians 15, I read that whenever I'm a little bit down. I turn to 1 Corinthians 15 and read it. And I'm going to read a passage from there this morning in 15, starting in verse 50. Paul says to the Corinthian brethren, he says, I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must be put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on the immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on the immortality, then shall come to pass a saying that is written. When we come out of that grave like Jesus did, and we put on the imperishable, the body that's prepared for us, then this will be true. This will come to pass. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. The true transformer of the world is Jesus. Jesus was buried, and Satan thought, I got him. I got victory. I put God in the grave. That's what he thought. And the apostles were terrified because they saw all this promise, didn't understand it all, but saw it all. And they said, what's going on? It's gone. We have no hope no more. We've lost hope. There's nothing for us. And then Jesus came out of that grave. There was joy. There was overwhelming exuberance. There was victory. He's alive again. And you got to know that the one that comes out of the grave doesn't die a second time. That's a good thing. Eternal life. He changed all of it. He's given us a hope and a future. He transformed everything so that we are no longer looking at suffering, at death, at any event in life, any circumstance, illness, destruction, persecution. I don't care what it is. We no longer have to look at it with fear. Isn't that a blessing? We do not have to fear anything. And we have everything to look forward to. Because he's given us everything. He's given us life eternal. Something that we didn't have until he came out of that grave. We have a future with our majestic King. That is a hope, my brothers and sisters. Jesus is the great transformer. He transformed everything from death to life. And this morning, he wants to transform you. If he has not transformed you, he wants to transform you. He wants to transform you from living in the kingdom of darkness to living in the kingdom of his marvelous light. He's waiting to transform you. If you haven't been transformed, why wait any longer? Why make him wait any longer? you can take this opportunity right now to commit your life to Christ and to live with him. We invite you to come while we stand and sing.
I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care. Though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that he is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart.